Welcome to H2K Infosys. H2K Infosys is a e-verify business based in Atlanta, Georgia, United States. We provide 100% job-oriented, instructor-led, face-to-face, true live online software training programs. It also includes access to cloud test lab with software tools. We provide live project for you to work on. We also provide assistance with mock interviews, resume preparation and review, and job placement assistance. H2K Infosys is trusted by so many students across the world. H2K Infosys provides world-class services in IT training with real-time project work for corporates and individuals, special IT training for MS students in the United States, software design, development, QA manual and automation, performance testing and maintenance, IT staff augmentation, job placement assistance and tech support.
See, once you have created the connection will get created in stop mode. That means the connection to the JMS provider, the connection to this JMS provider will get created in a stop mode. You are supposed to externally start the connection. If you didn't start the connection, then it won't send the message to the JMS provider and you won't be able to debug also. And the second thing is, at the JMS provider, it is not at all possible to verify whether the message has received or not. You can just have the capability of verifying how many number of messages are there. That's it. That's the only thing you can do. It's not possible to monitor at the JMS provider level. If the source has said that I have sent a message and the receiver has hasn't received the message, the receiver was, if this guy didn't get the message, then there is a problem with the sender only or some problem with the JMS communication. It's not at all possible for us to debug where exactly the message was available. That's a disadvantage with respect to our JMS.
Krish?
Yes.
Do you mind going to that API again,
go ahead.
Please? That one, the diagram, that this one, subscriber and the publisher, other one.
Okay.
Not this. There was a one pitch on image you opened. Yeah. Yeah. Here, not this. Yeah. Here, the second diagram. Is there anything going back to the client?
Here,
yeah. See, you, the client put the message, published. They received the message. Mm-hmm. Will they're sending something back from client to the topic?
Oh, if this guy wants, then if this guy is expecting some response, then this guy also can start one more conversation to the JMS destination. And this guy was supposed to listen to this particular topic to receive the message.
But
there is no synchronous communication that is going to happen between client 1 and client 3.
Will there not be any duplicates because the same message has been received by client 3 and client 4, and if both of them put the message back, won't the client 1 get confused as to why you are receiving multiple messages?
Well, that is based on our requirement. This is only used for notification purpose. This guy won't expect any kind of information from these two clients.
Okay.
In that case, only you will go for topic kind of communication. If
and
you want
client,
a response kind of mechanism, then you should go for point to point.
So will the client one will ever know how many people are receiving it? No, it will not know.
No, it's not at all required.
Okay. So there is no handshake available, meaning like a client will not know, assume that it is maintaining a status for every message, whether it has been received by the client or client.
The first thing I have mentioned is, for the source, it is not at all required how many number of receivers are available or who is getting the message. That is not at all required for the client who is sending the message. He's only discussing with the JMS destination, and this guy also, they are only discussing with the JMS destination, but not on the client side or the source side.
Okay, got it.
Yep.
Thanks.
Let us create one core Java project. So here we have mentioned about we need to use these seven objects, and also we need to perform the JNDI lookup. So I'm going to divide my whole Java file into three parts. The first one is I need to configure the JNDI first. Nothing but I need to provide all the properties like provider URL and the naming context factory and the URI packages. And the second thing is I will create a separate method for sending a message, and also I will write a separate method for receive message. But to work on queue or topic, first of all, I need to have the queue to be created on application server. AS means application server. It will be specified in short as AS. So to create any kind of queues or topics, you'll use the JMS destination sources. Expand this. Here you can see that queues and topics. Currently I have so many queues or topics available. Let us create one more queue. Click on queues. Here you can see that add a new resource. Select template, select some default one, click on continue. Here provide the name of the queue, H2K queue. Give the JNDI also. I'm giving the same JNDI name. That's it. Here you can see that unset was selected. If you want to select or if you want to set some value, uncheck this box. And then you can type the details, but currently you can leave all the defaults and click on save button. Now you can see that the H2K queue got created and it was in up status. If you want to delete, click on delete button, go to H2K queue. Here you can see that name of the queue is H2K queue and the consumer count and message count. Whenever you have created any kind of destination, let us say currently we have created a queue destination. So the queue, the destination will consist of a listener from the right side and the message producer from the left side. So the message producer will put the message onto the queue. That means that will be specified based on message count. How many number of messages are sent to the queue? The second thing is consumer count. From the right side, this guy was supposed to listen to the queue. So any number of consumers can listen to the queue. That will be specified at consumer count level. Once you are listening to this particular queue, this consumer count will get increased. Once you have sent the messages, the message count will get increased. Configuration, if you want to change the properties, or else metrics, if you want to see some other information, related to the statistics. If you want to clear the message or start or stop the destination, you can go for this particular option as well. Clear the topic also at the same time. There is no difference in creating queue or topic, but only thing is in terms of application server handling. Continue. H2K topic. Click on save button. Now one more topic got added here. If you click on JMS destination, it will provide you both queues and topics. So H2K queue was available and H2K topic was available. Check in your logs. So this is a H2K queue which we have created. And also here you can see that your topic has created and it has started for receiving the request. So once we have configured our administration step onto our application server, the next step is, see, currently this step has completed. So from the client side, you need to look up the JNDIs, the H2K queue and H2K topic, and you need to get the access to your JMS provider. So now let us write a client. So from the client, the first step is we need to get the access to the JNDI. We need to establish the connection to the JNDI. So I'm writing set context details method. Currently, we'll start with the context interface, new initial context. You can see that initial context, there are two constructors available. The second one is accepting a hash table object. So create one hash table with both strings. See, hash table, it's also just like your hash map. But this is legacy class. Environment properties dot put method, which accepts a string key and value pair. So the keys we have mentioned that we need to specify three keys. The first one is provider URL, initial context factory, URL packages. And I have mentioned that those are already available as static final variables within your context interface. You can see that all the required ones. Currently, I want provider URL, localhost, colon, you need to use 1099 is the port for JNDI. If you want, you can verify in the server side as well. Show you. See, here you can see that JNDA port, you double click on that just like you did on Tomcat server. Here you can see that 1099 is the port for JNDA access. Second property, context dot initial context factory, and the value you will get from your JNDA properties file. And the next one, you need to set the URL property. URL package prefixes. See, if you are using WebLogic, then you are supposed to set the class file corresponding to WebLogic. You can just Google for the dot properties file, the JNDI dot properties file location onto your WebLogic server, and you will get these two properties and set like just like this, whatever that we have done. So finally, you need to pass those properties to your initial context. So the initial context will make a connection to the JNDI port, and it will use this class to establish a connection, to get the details of global JNDI. So initial context will throw naming exception if there is any issue with the properties which you have set. So finally, return context object instead of returning null. So now you got the context object. Go to your main method and call this one. Set context details. This will return a context object. Add throws clause. Once you got the context object, the next step is you need to look up for the service. So currently, the first one is here. You can see that the lookup has accept lookup method. It's an overloaded method. You can just send the name of the object that you are expecting. Currently, to start with our JMS access, you need to get the connection factory JNDI lookup. So the name itself is the connection factory itself. So once after this, you just need to specify either you want the queue connection factory or the topic connection factory. So the context.lookup will provide you the top level object. You can convert this to queue connection factory or topic connection factory. Currently, the class was not available. It was available in a separate jar file. The jar file is javax.jms.jar file. You just need to download this jar file. I'll provide the link where you can download this jar file. These are all the jar files that are required for your client access. See, currently you are using some class file here, org.jnp.interfaces.namingcontextfactory. This class internally refers to some other classes as well, which will be available in some other jar files. So currently I have prepared what are all the jar files that are required. You can just take all those jar files and put it onto your class path, or else your JNDI access will throw an error. Or else let me put javax.jms jar only. We'll see what kind of exception it will throw, then we'll fix that error. Let me put only javax.jms.jar file. So currently we are working on queue, so I'm taking only queue connection factory. The second step is, once you got the connection factory, you are going to create the connection. The create connection method, you can see that the top level create connection method was available from connection factory, or else the low level method create queue connection. You can use any of them. The create queue connection, it will return a queue connection object. Take that one, because we need to use that connection and then only we can create the session. Once you got the connection, you are going to establish the session. So take your connection, and on the end you can see that there is a method create session. The create session method accepts two arguments. The first one is a Boolean argument and the next one is an integer. The first one represents either the connection or the session that we are creating, whether it involves with a transaction or not. If it involves with a transaction, it will send 3-4 messages by combining all of them, and it will send the messages at a single shot. If you don't want to involve with a transaction, then you can simply set that as a false, then you are going to send single message, and for each subsequent messages, you are going to create one more session. The next one is acknowledgement mode. Once you have sent the message to the JMS destination, you can expect an acknowledgement from the JMS provider that will be specified by session dot. Here you can see that there are different acknowledgement modes: auto acknowledge, client acknowledge, session transacted, or duplicate, okay acknowledge. Normally will follow as auto acknowledge, or else your JMS provider, sorry, your client, this guy will expect an acknowledgement from the JMS provider, nothing but it will expect an acknowledgement from some other side. Once you have created a session, here also you can create directly a session or you can create a queue session. I'm directly creating queue session. Once you got the session, start the connection. We have mentioned that the connection will be in stop mode only. You are supposed to externally start the connection. See, until this point, everything will be same even for the sender or receiver. He was supposed to establish the connection, he was supposed to establish the session, and he was supposed to look up for the destination as well. Next, look up again for the destination. So currently, what is our name? Our name is H2KQ. That is our destination. Convert that to Q because our destination is a Q. Once you got the Q, now you are supposed to create the message and you are supposed to create message producer or consumer in case of a queue. Currently we are working on queue level only. Now I'm going to write one more method, public void send message. So the send message was supposed to create the message and he was supposed to send the message to the queue. So these three, message or producer or consumer, are available from the session object. So I'm accepting a session object and I'm supposed to send the message to the queue. So the queue also available from the main method. So I'm accepting a queue as well. So now create, the first thing is create producer. Sending the message means create producer. Here you can see that there is a method called create producer and it accepts a parameter destination. So your destination can be either a queue or topic. Currently my destination is a queue. The create producer accepts the superclass reference and your queue or topic is derived from the destination class only. So that's why I'm able to send this one here. The return value for this is message producer. this will throw a JMS exception. Add this one there. And we have mentioned that your session is the one which is used for creating the message as well. So currently I want to write only a text message. So create a text message object. So once you got the text message, you just need to prepare the message, whatever that you want to send. You can call setter methods. Currently, setText method accepts a string parameter. So I'm going to write, I'm sending QMessage. This is my message, which I'm going to publish to the receiver. Finally, you need to produce the message. You can see that there is a send method for our producer. Send method accepts the message which you want to send. Once after that, once you have sent the message, it's your responsibility to close the producer, and it's your responsibility to close the session and also stop the connection as well, or else you are going to have an indefinite connection or indefinite JMS access to the provider, and the session will not be terminated properly by the application server. So here, call the method send message. As of now, make this as a static method. Session queue. That's it. Write some log messages. Connection factory. Lookup plus factory, and also before sending the message, sending the message to the queue, finally message sent. Currently, we are the one supposed to write either send message or receive message method. So let us write that method as well. Write one more method, receive message. See, even for our receive message also, we need to follow all these steps. So until this point, these are all common, and you need to create a message consumer this time, but not the producer. So go on and create the message consumer. So your session has the capability of creating either the producer or consumer. The consumer also accepts the queue from which it was supposed to read the message. Finally, the consumer consists of a message receive method. Return type for that is the top level message. You can directly convert that. You can directly convert that to a text message. If you are not sure, you can just verify whether it is an instance of text message or not, and then convert that to a text message object, because the normal message the top level interface, it doesn't contain a method getTextMessage or getText. Previously, we have sent the data by using setText, so we want to receive the message by using getText method. So I'm verifying whether it is an instance of text message or not. Once after that, I'm calling the getText method, which will provide the actual message from the queue. Here also write one statement, listening to the queue. Here, the consumer.receive method, the receive method indefinitely waits until a message has received from the JMS destination. So that means this guy,
so many of our students have given testimonials on how our training programs are. You will find them on kudzu.com and on our website h2kinfosys.com. On our website h2kinfosys.com, you will also find more detailed information on who we are, the courses that we offer, what each course covers. Also, if you're interested in a demo program, please register on our homepage on the left-hand side. Just give us more information about yourself and we will send you a link for a demo class. The demo class is absolutely free. Experience our commitment by just attending an orientation workshop at no cost. Our team of faculty and advisors are here to guide you with the right information. If you still have more questions, please feel free to call us. Call us at 770-777-1269. This is a United States number. If you're calling from the UK, call us at 020-337-17615. You can also email us at training@h2kinfosys.com or h2kinfosys@gmail.com. Thank you for watching our videos. We wish you a great career in information technology.